Dear viewers, we are going to see today the parotid salivary gland. The parotid is a serous salivary gland and it is the largest gland present by the side of the ear. And we have already reflected the skin flap of the face. Better we will remove the skin flap so that we'll be able to appreciate the gland morphology very well. Just orient yourself to the specimen. You can see this is the masseter muscle, and here is the ear pinna, right? And this is the sternocleidomastoid muscle. That's the emerging point of the external jugular vein. And here is the great auricular nerve. Okay. And the parotid salivary gland, if you see, it is an inverted three-sided pyramid having a base, apex, and three surfaces. This is the superficial surface, and you have a deep surface or medial surface, which is divided into two: anteromedial surface. This is the anteromedial surface, and here is the posteromedial surface, which is lying on the bed for the parotid gland, parotid bed. And apart from the main gland, you have an accessory parotid gland which is situated just above the parotid duct, which emerges from the anterior border, and this detached part is the accessory parotid gland. And the borders are, you have an anterior border, you have a posterior border, and then deep border is a medial border, which is related to the pharynx, and it is also called pharyngeal border. So three surfaces are separated by three borders. The anterior border separates the superficial surface from the anteromedial surface. The posterior border separates the superficial surface from the posteromedial surface. Now let us see the relations of these surfaces and borders. Now, come to the superficial surface. You have, the superficial surface, as you know, it is related to the platysma. Of course, the skin will be there. We have just removed it. Deep to skin, you have the superficial fascia containing the platysma muscle. And deeper to that, you have the branching of the great auricular nerve, then over the parotid fascia, the fascia. We have earlier seen the general investing layer splits at the lower aspect, that is at the apex of the parotid gland, into two layers, a superficial layer and a deep layer. The superficial layer is very tough and it is known as the parotid fascia. And also it lines the masseter, so together it is called parotidomassetric fascia. The deeper lamina is deeper to that, and it is attached to the base of the skull. The part between the styloid process and the angle of the mandible is thickened to form the stylomandibular ligament that separates the parotid gland from the submandibular salivary gland. Now coming to the anteromedial surface, the anteromedial surface is actually deeply grooved by the posterior border of the ramus of the mandible. What I'm touching here is the posterior border of the ramus of the mandible. So the surface is very much grooved. So you have an outer lip of the surface. There is an inner lip which is going deep to the ramus of the mandible. Okay. So the inner lip will be related to the medial pterygoid and ramus. The outer lip of the medial surface, anteromedial surface, is related to the masseter muscle. Now coming to the postromedial surface, I have just separated this surface from the sternomastoid muscle, and you can see this surface is the part of the, it's not the entire one, it is the part, the posterior part of the postromedial surface. There is another deeper part of the posteromedial surface which will be related to the styroid process. Now if you look at the structures related to it, okay, you have the mastoid process, and the structures attached to the mastoid process will be related to this part of the posteromedial surface. Okay, so it is overlapping the mastoid process and the sternomastoid muscle, and deeper you have the posterior belly of the digastric muscle, posterior belly, which is taking origin from the notch, the mastoid notch, right? And then you have another part of the posteromedial surface which is deeper, that deeply placed, and I have not exposed that part. That will be related to the styloid process and the structures attached to the styloid process, the three muscles and two ligaments. Plus deeper to that you will have the internal carotid artery and internal jugular vein will be related to the deeper part of the posteromedial surface. Okay, so superficial surface, this will be the part of the posteromedial surface, and here also is part of the anteromedial surface. The base of the gland is situated here, is seen here. This is the base of the gland. Can you see the base? It is also called superior surface. It is also called superior surface, and it is related to the cartilaginous part of the external acoustic meatus, and anteriorly it is related to the posterior part of the temporomandibular joint. So this surface which forms, this is whole thing is the base or the superior surface, which will be related to the external acoustic meatus, cartilaginous part, temporomandibular joint, and emerging from this surface you have these structures like the superficial temporal artery, which is dividing into an anterior branch and the posterior branch, and superficial temporal vein, and also you have the auriculotemporal nerve. Here is the auriculotemporal nerve. So these three structures are related to the superior surface. The apex is actually, if you see, it is directed downwards, and it is found in the digastric triangle, and it actually overlaps or flows over posterior belly of the digastric muscle, and even it is seen in the carotid triangle, the apex. Now if you see the apex is pierced by cervical branch of the facial nerve, and you will have the anterior and posterior division of the retromandibular vein. The anterior will be joining the vein is cut, joining the facial vein to form the common facial vein, and the posterior division will join the posterior auricular to form the external jugular vein. So the apex is related to cervical branch of the facial nerve, the retromandibular vein, the two divisions, and of course here in this case a branch of the great auricular nerve is going through the apex. It should be superficial, but probably it will be giving off branches deep to the gland and supplies the skin over it. So that's about the surfaces. And the borders, the anterior border is related to the terminal branches of the facial nerve, which we have already seen, and the radiating, okay, the nerves radiating. Here is the temporal branch, and this one is the zygomatic branch, and this one is the upper and lower buccal, and the joint also, okay. This is the buccal nerve, and here is a marginal mandibula, and that is a cervical. These are the five terminal branches of the facial nerve. Apart from that, you have the accessory parotid gland, okay, which is a detached part, sometimes it may be attached, and also the emergence of the parotid duct. Now look at the parotid duct. Now I must say a little bit about parotid duct. It's about 5 cm long, and it crosses the masseter muscle, and at the anterior border it turns medially, and I have removed the pad of fat over here, which is called the buccal pad of fat. So the duct pierces the buccal pad of fat, and then there was a fascia covering the buccinator muscle that has also been removed to expose the buccinator. This fascia is called the buccopharyngeal fascia, and so it pierces the buccopharyngeal fascia and then the buccinator muscle and opens into the vestibule of the mouth. This is the vestibule opposite to the crown of the second molar tooth. Now let us see the other border. You have the posterior border is here. Okay, the posterior border will be of course related to sternomastoid muscle, it and the mastoid process, right? And the deeper border, the medial border, which is not seen in the specimen unless we remove completely, you have the pharyngeal border or medial border. It is related to the lateral wall of the pharynx. That surface, posteromedial surface, is lying on the parotid bed. The parotid bed is mainly formed by the styloid process and the muscles taking origin from the styloid process, and the ligaments attached to the styloid process. And then, of course, the posterior belly of digastric and even the sternomastoid forms part of the bed. There will be gaps between these structures, and these gaps will be filled by extension of the glandular tissue. These are called the various processes of the parotid gland. So with this, the external aspect of the parotid gland is over. Now we'll remove the parotid gland in piecemeal or cut through the parotid gland at the nervous plane to see the facial nerve and the other blood vessels which are inside the parotid gland in the next specimen. Now over to Dr. Raj Prasad.
This is the parotid gland with the parotid duct. When the parotid gland is inflamed, it will be highly painful because of the thick parotidomasseteric fascia which is covering that. This fascia is derived from inversing layer of the deep cervical fascia. Because this fascia is unyielding, whenever there is inflammation of the parotid gland, the gland cannot swell, so that leads to severe pain. Parotid gland is most commonly infected in viral infections. Most common viral infection which leads to parotitis is mumps. Apart from the viruses, bacteria can also cause infection of the parotid gland, which is called as bacterial sialadenitis, and that can lead to pus collection within the gland. If the gland is infected with pus, the pus has to be drained by making a horizontal incision over the skin of the parotid gland. This horizontal incision is because to avoid damaging the facial nerve fibers which are radiating from the parotid gland. Whenever the parotid duct is obstructed with a stone formation, that condition is called as sialolithiasis. The duct may be formed at the junction of the collecting ducts or at the distal end of the parotid duct near the parotid papilla. The stones in the parotid ducts are mostly radiolucent, so it can be diagnosed by a procedure called as a sialography, where a contrast dye is injected through the opening of the parotid duct from the mucosa, and the radiograph will be taken. Thank you.